problems and creating chaos, and they may not even know what they're doing. But you understand who is for the immigration thing and what it's really about. It serves, you know, twofold, of course, the clash of civilizations, the clash of cultures. They get the consumers. So this is, you know, the way they want to increase business. They put more demand. So the whole supply and demand thing comes into play. And so all the business interests are satisfied. Landlords benefit from it. Anybody selling anything benefits from it. Now, people providing services, the average labor out there, they do not benefit. They lose from it because, you know, then they say, oh, well, supply and demand, we got all this extra labor. Now, sorry, wages are going down. Even when wages have been going down by mere virtue of the fact that they haven't kept up with the cost of living. And mathematically speaking, you see, there's no difference from, you know, your cost of living being stable and your wages continually going down than if your wages stayed, you know, increased slightly, but your cost of living soared. It's the same effect. It's the same mathematically speaking. You get the same thing, okay? So understand how this thing works and how your currency has been debased to the tune of 90 to 95% in the aggregate, the cost price index aggregate. And, you know, what they're trying to do now is just squeeze every last percentage point they can. So all the tyranny you take, you'll get. Like it's been written, was it Thomas Jefferson or Thomas Paine that said, you know, the degree of tyranny that you accept is the degree you will receive. And that's exactly what's going on. So we're really being pushed. We're really being tested to see how much poverty we will tolerate, how abject that poverty we tolerate will be, and you know, how great the wealth disparity we will allow. When there's this great wealth on the planet now, when everybody could be living in great luxury and great prosperity, zero homelessness, zero hungry people, zero thirsty people, zero people in want of any trinket, knick-knack, luxury items, whatever the case, whatever you want. Everybody on the face of the earth could be living in that state today. But we've got the opposite thing going. So how much of that opposite thing will you accept? That's a question we all have to ask ourselves. And I, for one, say don't. But do I have any faith that we're going to turn it around? I really don't. To be quite honest with you, I believe it's going to take the literal return of Jesus to turn this ship around. I really do. So, you know, I say fight the good fight and, you know, mostly try to awaken people that are asleep, that are inadvertently evil and are going to end up going to hell, to the same place our evil overlords are going, but they don't know it. And, you know, we've got to just let these people know what we're looking at here. And to simply let people know that short of the return of Jesus, as bizarre as that might sound, I do believe the literal interpretation that good will prevail on this earth because good is stronger than bad, that love is stronger than hate, right is stronger than wrong, okay? And that is the logic and reason behind this idea that good will prevail on the earth. But what it's going to take is another story. Because all through the ages, it's been violence, right, that finally overthrew the oppressive dictatorships, the tyrannies, the, you know, the oppressors, was finally overthrown through violence. And we're at a point in history where that's not going to be the case. I don't think anybody sees that happening. This is going to have to be a peaceful change, a peaceful revolution, this ushering in of a new age where we understand exactly what it's going to take for us to live together in peace and harmony and safety and security and freedom and contentment. All those good things, for us to have those things for ourselves and for our children, our children's children. It's going to take dramatic and profound changes. And one of those changes, let's face it, is going to be the fact that we're going to have to render the God of this world money irrelevant. And the first step, I mean, if we were going to do this in a political manner, which has nothing to do with Democrat and Republican, just politically speaking, through the powers of the Politburo, then we would have to, we the people, would gain control of the currency issuance. That's it. There's no, short of doing that, we the people deciding whether a country is going in debt or not is decided by the people. What industries we get to keep and which ones we choose to share or give to other nations is our prerogative as American citizens. We can do that. But I don't really see that happening. I see these forces as way too powerful, and that there's not enough people that either know or they don't have the courage to stand against these people and demand that this is exactly what we want. And the only signature that's going to be on those dollar bills is going to be drawn by a lottery. And it could be your name on the dollar bill or my name. The point is that you're after sound currency as a means to an end. You're after using capitalism to get what you want. And that's not for some people, that's for all the people. By utilizing supply and demand economic principles, Austrian economics, understand what this means. In light of the fact that humanity makes progress, we become more civilized, we find easier and easier methods to produce the things we first and foremost need, essential human needs, that is, food, shelter, and water. Beyond that, the things we want. And so as we do that, we end up finding these better ways of doing it, and we provide an excess, a superfluity, if you will, of the things that we want and need. So our work week is in decline, and our biggest challenge becomes finding what to do with our spare time, like all the other animals. They have that same challenge. They're here on God's green earth, and they have to figure out what they want to do with this life they've been given. So that's going to be your challenge. That's nothing anybody can fix for you. You'll have to decide that on your own. But what I'm saying is that you could be free. And the way you would be free through sound currency, as so many other great men have understood through the ages, is through universal prosperity. That's universal freedom. That's universal security. That's being free from the money masters, from the god of this world, from Satan. And so the way sound currency would do that was through progress, increasing in value, inflating, in other words. And that's how it's rendered irrelevant. People care less and less about it because they're all secure, they're all prosperous, and they feel free. And this is the net result of sound currency. This is how it works. This is the logic and reason behind it. And it's a very radical idea. True capitalism, true supply and demand free market principles are very radical, because this is the net effect, is that nobody is able to hold it over you and have that great advantage while you're starving to death and you're at that great disadvantage. That cannot be carried out anymore in a system like that. And that's why our overlords know, and this is the most imperative thing they can keep us under, is this poverty. Because with the poverty comes the war. Take away the poverty, the dubious warfare goes away. Take away the poverty, the crime dries up. So again, they need the poverty so they can have the prison industrial complex, they can have the high crime, the need for all these arbitrary laws and whatnot to, you know, it's a business they're running here. And it revolves around the problems being perpetuated, the debt. This is the number one thing. This is how they enslave the populaces. Okay, is through the debt. So you couldn't do that if people are all prosperous, could you? You understand how they function, then you can understand your way out. And what I'm saying is very radical stuff, but you know, here it is, and anybody that listens can pass it on, because I know what I'm talking about. Yeah, indeed, world events in 2015, you know, are enough to make you sick to your stomach, so. Anyhow, I'm going to wrap this video up. I've got to go do a chemtrail rally video here in a little while. But, you know, this so-called reality is nothing more than an engineered dystopia, as far as I'm concerned. And this system is unsound by design. But, you know, there was this hidden video on this abortion thing, taking the body parts off the fetuses. And here's another thing that would dry up with prosperity, because, I mean, who are the women having abortions? They're scared, financially insecure women that are having these abortions. So that, again, would go away, all that nonsense. And Greece, you know, that they're not being allowed to go the way of Iceland and find liberty and just denounce this illegitimate debt. Anyhow, lastly, I just want to do a shout out to the Alex Jones channel. I just got finished this morning listening to Alex Jones, and I have great regard for this man because he's super intelligent, super outspoken, super brave, and I admire the heck out of him and his whole staff too. David Knight was talking about Trump and talking about this love of money and how this is a great transgression. It's the worst thing. It's causing all our problems. He's absolutely right. And, you know, I really admire his compunction and his courage to speak out about that. And all these other guys, too. I mean, you're Darren McBreen, you're Rob Dew, Joe Biggs, and Jakari Jackson, Leanne McAdoo. I have great regard for all these guys. I think they're fantastic. And I really appreciate, you know, the fact that he's got this great crew, this great group of reporters over there. And it'd be really fun to work with these guys. But I imagine there's an awful lot of people out there that would love to be involved with the InfoWars crew. But, you know, I really admire these people. They